Namaste children, today we are going to see in history chapter 3, ruling the countryside, part 1. When the British came to India, villages were self-sufficient units. Most of the things that the villagers needed were produced in the village itself. The farmer owned the land he cultivated and he paid a small part of his produce to the king. If the crops failed due to natural calamities such as floods and droughts, the king reduced the land revenue or sometimes totally wrote it off. The coming of the British, however, changed the situation. On 12th August 1765, the Mughal Emperor appointed the East India Company as the Diwan of Bengal. As Diwan, the company became the chief financial administrator of the territory under its control. The actual event most probably took place in Robert Clive's tent with a few Englishmen and Indians as witnesses. But in the painting, the event is shown as a majestic occasion taking place in a grand setting. The painter was commissioned by Clive to record the memorable events in Clive's life. The grant of Diwani clearly was one such event in British imagination. In return, the company got the right to collect revenue of Bengal, Bihar, and Orissa. Present day we call it as Odisha. Now, company was using this revenue to meet their own expenses like maintenance of military and buy goods for trading. Also, company understood itself the trader and wanted to become an authority. Within 5 years, the economy of Bengal fell drastically. The peasants or farmers and artisans were leaving their villages as they had to sell their goods deliberately in low prices. The companies got affected. To solve this crisis, company took a cunning move and introduced permanent settlement. Then the Governor General, Lord Cornwallis, introduced a revenue system which is known as permanent settlement in 1793. With this, the landlords, the Rajas and Talukdars were asked to collect money from the peasants or farmers and pay revenue to the company. The amount which was to be paid was fixed and was not to be changed even in the future. It ensured the fixed income for company and at the same time zemindars to invest in improving the land. The zemindars started to benefit themselves from the increased production from the land as the revenue demand remained same. But this settlement system also had some problems and those were mainly related to the peasants. The problems of permanent settlement was basically done so that the British get a fixed revenue and the zemindars encourage land reforms. The officials realized the zemindars were not taking any efforts to improve their lands. As the revenue that was fixed was too high and the zemindars found it difficult to pay. Failing to pay the revenue resulted in loss of zemindari. And so numerous zemindars lost their land and their zemindari as well. By the first decade of the 19th century, the market prices rose and cultivation slowly expanded, changing the situation. But the cultivators were oppressed and found it difficult to cultivate, since there was no interest in the zemindars to improve the land. The insecurities of the right of their land, raised as the rent, paid to the zemindars were too high. They often had to take loans from moneylenders at high interest in order to pay their rents. If farmers was unable to repay their loans, he was to be evicted from their lands. To rule in India, the British needed a continuous supply of money and for that they introduced many revenue systems. First, they introduced permanent settlement, but when this system failed, British introduced many other revenue systems. The most important amongst them were the Mahalwari and the Roitwari land revenue systems. Now, let us first study about the Mahalwari settlement. The Mahalwari system of land revenue was introduced in 1822 by Holt Mackenzie. Mahal means a group of villages. So in this system, the revenue was collected from a group of villages. He asked the collectors to go village to village, measuring the fields and recording the customs and rights of different groups. The estimated revenue that each village had to pay was calculated by adding up each plot within the village. The revenue was not fixed, but it was revised periodically based on the fertility of the soil. The village headman was responsible for collecting and paying the revenue to the company. Now, let us understand the Roitwari system. Roit means farmers or cultivators. So, in this system, the dealing was directly done with the farmer and no other middlemen were involved. Direct settlement with the peasants. Captain Alexander Reid tried it on a small scale in some of the areas which were taken by the British after defeating Tipu Sultan. Subsequently developed by Thomas Munro, the Roitwari system spread all over the south. Before making the revenue assessment, the fields were carefully and separately surveyed. The desire to increase the land revenue income, revenue officials fixed high revenue. However, farmers were unable to pay this high amount. The Roits fled the countryside and villages became deserted in many regions. So, we can say that this revenue settlement system proved to be very disadvantageous for poor farmers as well as for the British. Here we can see the different land revenue policies of the British. They are permanent settlement in the regions of Bengal, Bihar and Orissa, Roitwari system in South Indian regions and Mahalwari system in Northwest regions. Here the British officers were being introduced two important land revenue systems. They were a Mahalwari settlement and the Roitwari system. Here the Mahalwari system, they have the middlemen like the zemindars, where these zemindars will be collected revenue from the peasants or the farmers and they will be paid to the Britishers. Next, Roitwari system, where they will have a direct connections or a link with the peasants and they will be collected revenue from them directly. Crops for Europe and demand for Indian indigo. India was one of the largest raw material supplies for the Britain. Indian cash crops were in great demand in England, so the company forced Indian cultivators to cultivate them. One such crop which was in great demand in the European market was indigo. Indigo plant was used for producing the blue color and India was the largest supplier of it in the 19th century world market. Here we can see two images of cotton prints. The image on the left shows a kalamkari print created by weavers of Andhra Pradesh in India. On the right is a floral cotton print designed and produced by William Morris, a famous poet and artist of 19th century in Britain. There is one thing common in the two prints. Both use a rich blue color which is commonly called indigo. The blue that we see in these prints was produced from a plant called indigo. It is likely that the blue dye used in the Morris prints in 19th century Britain was manufactured from indigo plants cultivated in India. For India was the biggest supplier of indigo in the world at the time. India is a tropical country and Indian indigo grows well in tropical regions. In the 13th century, Indian indigo was used by the cloth manufacturers from France, Italy, and Britain. The manufacturers used the indigo color to dye cloths. Indigo was very expensive, so the European cloth manufacturers were dependent on another plant called oat. Oat was cultivated in Italy, southern France, and parts of Germany and Britain. So, it was easily available in the European markets. Fearing the competition from indigo, oat producers demanded the ban on import of indigo. However, the dye from oud was dull and pale, so the dyers preferred indigo over oud for its rich blue color. The government was forced to relax the ban on indigo import. Many European countries started cultivating indigo in different parts of the world. Due to industrialization in Britain, cotton production expanded to produce cloths. Cloths needed dye, which led to high demand for indigo. West Indies and America were not able to meet the high demand of indigo. So cloth dyers in Britain needed new source of indigo. Therefore, the company decided to expand the area under indigo cultivation in India. Indigo cultivation in Bengal expanded rapidly and it started to dominate the world market. With the growth of indigo trade, commercial agents and officials of the company invested more in indigo production. Many company officials left their jobs and took up indigo plantation. Attracted by high profits, many Englishmen came to India and became indigo planters. Indigo produced in India was in great demand in the European markets. So many Europeans became planters and started indigo cultivation in India. There were two main systems of indigo cultivation are niche system and royalty system. In niche cultivation, the planters produced indigo on the lands which were under his direct control. They produced indigo by directly employing hired laborers. Indigo could be cultivated only on fertile lands, and these were all densely populated. Planters needed large lands for indigo cultivation. They tried to rent the lands around the indigo factory and evict the farmers from the area. Indigo plantation required large number of laborers, but laborers were busy in rice cultivation, so it was difficult to make them work on indigo plantation. Niche cultivation needed many ploughs and bullocks. Investing in the purchase and maintenance of ploughs was a big problem. The existing ploughs and bullocks were busy in rice fields. Till the late 19th century, planters were not ready to expand their area under niche cultivation. The other main system of indigo cultivation is the royalty system. Under the royalty system, the planters forces royts, that is farmers, to sign a contract. At times, village headmen were also pressurized to sign the contract on behalf of the royts. Those who signed the contract were given cash advances from the planters at low rates of interest to produce indigo. As per the contract, the royts had to cultivate indigo on at least 25% of the land. The planters provided the seeds and the drill, and the cultivators prepared the soil and sowed the seeds. After the crop was delivered to the planter, a new loan was provided to the royt, starting the cycle all over again. Royts received very little prices for indigo production and the loan cycle never ended. Indigo could be cultivated in the best soils, but farmers wanted to cultivate rice on those land. Indigo cultivation exhausted the fertility of the soil. After the indigo cultivation, land could not be used to cultivate rice again. That is, indigo cultivation also led to infertility of the soil. After indigo harvest, the land could not be used for rice cultivation. Here in this chart, we can see how the royalty system where forces royts to cultivate the indigo crops. Here, we are going to talk about the scenario related to indigo plantation. Cultivation methods, we have already known about it. In continuation to that, we want to see that when royt and his cultivations of indigo taking place, what was the result of it? Giving loans to the royts by the planter, charging high interest rates, make royts to go in a cyclic manner to keep producing indigo and keep taking loans, which was harmful for the peasants. Similar thing happened particularly in Bengal, where indigo plantation became very aggressive. It was in the year of 1859 that a revolution named as Blue Rebellion. Now, this rebellion is marked against the aggressive methods of planters. because it was the planters who were forcing the cultivators to sign up for contract. These planters were also forcing the village headmen and also sometimes zamindars to sign the contract and keep sowing indigo. So it was forced attempt. Rohits never wants to do that. They wanted to cultivate rice or some other crops which is edible, which can be sold in India and on profit. Anyway, it was against oppressive methods of planters attempt of making peasants sow indigo. Secondly, this rebellion started happening in 1859 after the revolt of 1857, the first war of independence. It was a great significance because it was in this the planters were on one side and the zamindars, the village headmen, also the cultivators or rohits were on the other side. So you can see it was suddenly after continuous efforts being made by village headmen to pitch a rebellion against the planters. This was rebellions against planters which was pitched by the village headmen to motivate the rohits to come and fight against the planters against their oppression. So this is the reason they were no more silent. They got the strength motivated by the various village headmen who were suffering by planters because the planters were asking to sign up contract. So they motivated rohits. Even zamindars also have the rights because zamindari's positions was in danger as the planters, they became more powerful, they got more land, so the zamindars wanted to oppose them as well. All of them got together to fight against planters. So this rebellion started happening in Bengal in this region in 1859 and it became very violent. Because here rohits also started raising arms using bow, arrows and spears and also women of the rohits like housewives or other people around them, they started using kitchen utensils to raise war against the planters. So these planters used to send their men to charge rent from these rohits of the land that they have given to them to sow indigo. There is a violent struggle started happening between the planters and also between the cultivators or the rohits. So this is one scenario as it blow out the proportion as it start becoming huge and huge. And this rohits completely denied to pay any rent, taxes and so indigo. Suddenly, during that time, the political scenario, India was so that the Britishers were already worried that any other revolt can be harmful for their staying in India. Already they have seen in 1857 revolt and now they were not in mood to see again any such revolt. So they decided to intervene. So the Britishers or the Queen who came after 1857 revolt started to intervene in the Blue Rebellion. There was a tour which was made in Bengal by the governor of Bengal, that is the lieutenant governor, at that point in time, and then efforts were made to not let plant rohits and cultivators suffer. So strong measures were taken against planters who were forcing the forced cultivation of indigo. This was considered a move by cultivators, a very sympathetic move, as a Britishers were helping the rohits not to sow indigo. They were very impressed by the Britishers. Also, there was another commission which was set up known as Indigo Commission, in which the magistrate Eden make a judgment saying no forced indigo cultivation can happen. So you cannot do any forced cultivation. The Queen of England also at that point in time clearly said that no forced cultivation will happen. So this was the scenario. It was win-win situation for the rohits or cultivators as they thought that won against the planters. So the planters will remove their power and the land also taken. So it was a win-win situation as the rohits no more has to grow the indigo. But what happened After it? Well, after it, many of the people also visited Bengal. Many Western scholars and reformers also visited Bengal to write about abrasive nature of indigo plantation that was taken place. Not only this, in Bengal, indigo plantation was stopped because of the major orders, but it started moving to Bihar. In Bihar, these rich planters started carrying an indigo plantation and synthetic dyes were produced late 19th century. So the operation started going there. When Gandhi had come back in 1915 from South Africa, a person from Bihar asked Gandhi to visit Chambaran by saying that do something against the abrasive nature of indigo plantation happening in Bihar. So after Blue Rebellion in Bengal, started in Bihar as well. So Gandhi himself intervened to bring end this abrasive practice of indigo cultivation in Bihar as well. This was a big rebellion that had taken place against abrasive practice of planters. In the early 18th century, a French missionary, Jean-Baptiste Labat, who traveled to the Caribbean islands and wrote extensively about the region, published in one of his books. This image shows all the stages of indigo production in the French slave plantations of the region. So with this glossary, we have been completed this lesson, that is in history, lesson 3, ruling the countryside. Thank you.